Well, vacation's over. It's time to get back into studying the Word of God. We're in Understanding the Kingdom, Part 16 today. And I want to go to the book of Joshua. We have entered into a pivotal place in the Word of God. It's now time for them to take the promised land. They have obeyed God. The last generation refused to cross the Jordan out of fear. And they basically accused God, saying, "You're bringing us into that land so that our children will die at the hands of the enemy." And Almighty God said, "You know what? You're going to die in the wilderness. And your children are going to raise up and they're going to take the land." And as I was putting this together this morning, one of the things that really stuck out to me, especially where we are in history, where we are with prophetically the way things are going, how that the kingdom of God, there is a synchronicity to it that you couldn't plan yourself. That there's a turning point as we go into the new civil year, and I think it will pick up speed and it will explode by the time we get to the next holy year, which begins 14 days before Passover, is that God is equipping this generation to fight the fights the last generation wouldn't fight. Because it's time for us to go on. And so I want to look at setting things in order for the battle. How many know that you don't go into battle haphazard? You don't go into the battle just willy-nilly. That there is a way of doing it. When I was in the military, all of our equipment was basically called TA-50. And it was all your gear that you used. That there was a certain way that it had to be rigged. There were certain supplies that you had to have in it. Everything had to be set in order for you to be able to be prepared for combat no matter what came. And I think it's the same thing in the kingdom of God. Let's go to Joshua chapter 5. And I want to start here with verse 2. And what's interesting is the whole time that they were wandering in the wilderness and they were having new children, they never circumcised anybody. That was until after they circumcised them first before they left Egypt. And now we're getting into this next generation that's going to have to fight. And so God comes to Joshua and he says this, "And at this time the Lord said unto Joshua, make thee sharp knives and circumcise again the children of Israel the second time." And then he goes on to explain that all the men of war that were circumcised, that were in covenant with God, that had this circumcision representing that covenant, that were men of war that came out of Egypt, all of them had died. And now you have a new generation that are getting ready to go into war, and they have to have the seal of the covenant on the inside of them. And I think one of the things that God is requiring of us, how many know there's a difference in the circumcision of the flesh, but even after God did it the first time with Israel, down by Mount Sinai, and they ended up with the golden calf and all kinds of crazy stuff. He said, "I wish I would have circumcised your heart." In Messiah, we have circumcision of heart. And so God is saying, listen, we have got to prepare this next generation. We have got to prepare our hearts. The unregenerated heart longs for Babylon. It longs for the things of this world. It longs for the things of the flesh. But a circumcised heart longs for the things of the kingdom of God. And for us to fight this battle, you cannot long for what you're supposed to fight against. And that has been the problem with the last several generations of the church, is that we have been longing for the very things, acceptance by the very things that we were called of God to conquer and to subdue. And guys, we got to get on top of this before the Lord comes back. He is not coming back for a church that's longing for Babylon. He's coming back for a church that's longing for the New Jerusalem, that's longing for the millennial reign, that's longing to see the kingdoms of darkness put completely under the feet of Jesus on this planet. And so it's something that we definitely need to do. Now, it goes on to say, because this, I'm going to pick up in verse 7, we're going to be going kind of just through this chapter, that once they were circumcised, God did something. We need to understand that whenever you do something in your life, God will do something also. Now, we come into the kingdom by what Jesus did, But the Bible says God is a rewarder of those that diligently seek Him. I can never seek God without God doing something in kind in my life. And for a lot of people, well, let me add this. For a lot of people, they're not seeking God. They're seeking relief from their circumstance. That's not seeking God. Seeking God is seeking Him no matter what. And He's either going to give you the power to go through the circumstance, the power to bring that circumstance underfoot and get it out of the way. But when you seek God, there's always a going through. But what we have done is we have built generations that would rather go around. And so what we do is we seek an easy solution rather than what the King wants and seek His face. That's part of that circumcision of heart. Not my will, but thine be done. We have got to have that. Picking up here in verse 7, and their children whom they had raised up in the stead, then Joshua circumcised, for they were uncircumcised, because they had not circumcised them by the way. And it came to pass when they had done circumcising all the people, they abode in their place in the camp until they were whole. And the Lord said unto Joshua, this day I have rolled away the reproach of Egypt from off you. Wherefore the name of the place is called Gilgal unto this day. Now when they enter, what's interesting is just a verse before this, they looked at this and said, we're calling this the hill of circumcision. And God says, no, you don't understand. I had something in mind when I called you to circumcise yourselves. That this is now called Gilgal because I am rolling away the reproach of Egypt off of you. We need to understand these were covenant people. This is talking about God bringing them to a pivotal moment, just like Almighty God brings us to a pivotal moment, that all of a sudden we have to choose to be obedient to God and allow Him to circumcise our hearts. And what's interesting, let me rephrase that. God doesn't circumcise your heart, you do. All the commands in the Old Testament, even when it talks about circumcision of heart, God says, you circumcise your heart. Just like it was an act of physical circumcision, you have got to choose God, you have got to choose His ways. It is a pivotal point because in that circumcision, Egypt and the connection to Egypt got broke off of them. And yet we have Christians today that are Freemasons that is based upon Egyptian ritual magic. Just because somebody puts a Bible on an altar does not make that a Christian place. Especially when they got a Quran sitting right next to it. Or if you go into China and they may have the writings of Confucius sitting right next to it. And all their symbolism is out of Egypt. I thought God delivered us out of that. God is wanting us to get to the place that if we will allow Him to instruct us on how to circumcise our hearts, that the reproach, because there is still a reproach and the stench of Egypt on God's people. That's why sometimes, it's getting to the place. Well, this is some of the things I'm going to add to my book. They're teaching yoga in church. In churches, they're having yoga classes. Every pose in yoga is a prayer to a pagan deity. And the experts from India say that you cannot disconnect yoga from the religion. It's impossible. It is a spiritual act. I got a call here a few weeks back from a woman down in Arkansas, and this is going on in spirit-filled, charismatic Pentecostal churches. They're having Reiki masters coming up from Japan, doing healing, being able to manipulate the magnetic waves and the chakras of people, and they call that laying on of hands. No, it's not. It is paganism, and it is the reproach of Egypt. I had someone send me a link in this one church. They were so far tattooing that while the pastor was preaching, sitting right next to the pulpit, a woman was getting a tattoo while he was preaching. Even though the Word of God says, thou shalt not get a tattoo, I am the Lord thy God. We can go on and on and on. The reproach of Egypt has stunk up the church. because we will not circumcise our hearts. Once our hearts are circumcised, that becomes stench to us, and we no longer want it. What we desire is the kingdom of God. What we have had in this last generation is there are ebbs and flows to the presence of God. That happens with every generation. God said this, he told Israel this, there are ebbs and flows. He said, I'll even let false, and when there's this ebb, God says, I'll let a false prophet come in. Everything he says will come to pass. But he'll take you away from my word. And I'm testing you to see if you love me or you just love signs and wonders. If you just love spiritual things. The New Testament church, the charismatic church, the Baptist church, the evangelical churches have failed the test. All of us categorically, and many in the Hebraic Roots movement, has failed the test because they have fallen in love with Judaica and they have forgotten about Jesus. Time to circumcise the heart. When this one goes out, there's a lot of people going to be happy. I got a feeling I'm going to get a lot of emails, both pros and con. But guys, it is time to remove the reproach of Babylon off of us. We can no longer walk as pagans and claim to be citizens of the kingdom of God. It is impossible. God is calling us to be something else. Now, I want you to hold your page there in Joshua, and I will go to Philippians chapter 2. Just so that you just think I'm not preaching all Old Testament. You know, last time I checked, the Word of God was supposed to start in Genesis and go all the way through Revelation, and it's in harmony with one another. Now, this is the Apostle Paul writing to those who had been saved. He was writing to the church. He was writing to the church leadership. Now listen what he says. Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. In other words, once you come into that salvation, there's some things that you're going to have to work out. And you do it with fear and trembling before a holy God. Is that present in today's church? Or do you just say a little 3-minute prayer if you're lucky? Sometimes it's a 30-second prayer. Because we have went from converting souls to checking off a list to say that, you know, this month in church we had 50 saved, and so now it has expanded the size of the church. It has not expanded the size of the church, because what you have is a room full of pagans with a few saints scattered and abroad that have worked out their salvation with fear and trembling. And so what we do to keep the money flowing and to keep everything going, instead of following God, we begin following all these unconverted souls that say, you know what, I like this from Babylon. I like this from Egypt. I want this in my church. I've got to have strobe lights. I've got to have fog. I've got to have rock and roll in the church. I've got to have all these things in the church. Well, you might as well go on down to a disco or go down to the nightclub, because sometimes there's no difference. Except instead of a comedian getting up and telling a few jokes, you have a preacher get up and give a 15-minute sermonette. And you think, we are the church. No, you're not. You're the whore of Babylon. Because there is no working out our salvation with fear and trembling. This Greek word, work out, in the Greek, now it's this long. I'm not going to try to pronounce it this morning. But it is Strong's number 2716. Sometimes speaking in tongues is easier than speaking in Greek. I do Hebrew so much better. But this workout means to perform, to accomplish, to achieve, to work out, to do that from which something results, to fashion or render one fit for a thing. To render one fit for a thing. You see, what you have been called to be in God, once you make Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior of your life, now God is requiring you on the inside, in your spirit you have been born again, but now God is requiring you in your soul and on the outside to begin rendering fit what He has done on the inside. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. I love the next one. I have claimed this so many times in my life, for it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do His good pleasure. That's one of the things I pray every morning. God, I have my agenda today, but what I am praying is the Holy Spirit's living on the inside of me the day that I made Jesus Christ Lord and Savior of my life, and therefore I am inviting you to change my will. Cause me to will. Now, I love the way the Apostle Paul does this. Because there's no frustration. How many of us have willed to do something? I have willed to be skinny. How many know that the do isn't quite there yet? And that's frustrating. Whenever you have the want to, but you don't have the can do, you end up with frustration. But what God says here is in His kingdom it's balanced. If we let the Holy Spirit do His work, He'll give you the want to and the can do. Which is the exact same thing God was doing for them all the way back in Joshua when He was requiring them to take Jericho. He gave them the want to and He gave them the can do. But it's according to His principles and His ways. We could go all the way back. I don't know if it's easy access here. It's one of these things you should have done before I preached. I've got a 3-volume set here by Fletcher. 4 volumes. Fletcher was a protege of John Wesley. And what he had to fight in his generation is the same thing we have to fight in ours. It's called easy believism. Say this 30-second prayer and you get your golden ticket from Willy Wonka to go on to heaven. And then you can live like you want to. The only thing changes is where you go for a few hours on the weekend. You're not saved. If salvation doesn't take a hold of the whole person, it's not salvation. It is not salvation. We've got to fight easy believism. Jesus said, you will know them by their fruit, and then the Word of God begins defining what the fruit is. And we have got to get to the place, guys, in where we're headed. You have got to know those that have been circumcised in their hearts. They become kindred spirits. It allows us to separate the sheep from the goats. And one of the first thing that if the first thing comes out of their mouth is, I want, they're a goat. Because when a goat says, thus saith the Lord, they'll go, nah, nah. Don't want it, no. But if it's, I'm seeking the will of God, I want the will of God in this matter, that's a good sign that maybe somebody has a circumcised heart. Now I want you to look here again at the synchronicity of the kingdom. God comes to them, says, you're going to take Jericho, you're coming into the promised land, I'm having you circumcise the flesh. And He did it in perfect timing so that they would all be healed up by the time of Passover. Isn't God awesome? Verse 10 of Joshua chapter 5. Now the children of Israel and Captain Gilgal kept the Passover on the 14th day of the month at evening in the plains of Jericho. So they're at Jericho. They're in the plains surrounding the city of Jericho. And all of Israel is celebrating Passover. They're remembering what Almighty God did for them. And it's good to know before you go into battle, one of the things that is good to do is to remember everything that God has done for you so that you can tap in to build your faith. You see, this was faith building. They were in blood covenant. They were reminded of the covenant of Abraham, of the physical covenant. Now God takes them to the covenant He made with them when He delivered them out of Egypt. and how the mightiest nation on the planet was taken down to its knees without them having to lift a sword. You see, there's power in communion. There's power when you take communion in your life. There's power in when you remember what God has done for you. There's power in it. And sometimes we just need to sit down and take a catalog and go through and review, especially when you get in a tough spot. How many know now this is the first time the children of Israel have really had to raise up and say, it's time for you to take the city. First time. And so God says, okay, circumcision, heart, set things in order. Get your heart right. Remember what I have done. Remember my covenant with you. Can you see how God is just taking them through and getting things set up? Now, the next thing that happened, there are a lot of people right now in the charismatic movement don't understand this, that when this happens, they're all going to think that they miss God somehow or another, when actually they're right on with what God wanted. Circumcision, setting your house in order, Passover. In verse 11 it says, and that they did eat the old corn of the land. So they themselves have captured something, they have gotten something where they have corn from the promised land that they're eating. On the morrow after the Passover, unleavened cakes and parched corn in the same self day, and the manna ceased on the morrow after they had eaten of the old corn of the land. Neither had the children of Israel manna anymore, but they did eat the fruit of the land of Canaan that year. This is significant. Most Christian ministry, especially charismatic ministry, is based on the ability to produce manna. You give an offering, money's going to fall from the sky. You do this, angels are going to fall from the sky. Everything's falling from the sky. What always falls from the sky? Manna. And now God is saying, you're transitioning, you're coming in, you're learning how to be a warrior in my kingdom. Now it's going to be my anointing flowing through you, creating the blessing. That's how grown-ups live. How many know little kids, unless they're really, really impoverished, little kids usually don't worry about where the next meal is going to come from. It falls from the hands of mom and dad. It just, you know, mama somehow or another, just the money shows up and the food shows up, and I tell mama what I would like and she fixes it. And so it's just like manna falling from heaven. But then eventually you grow up, you move out of the house, and you discover there's something required that's called a job. And if you work enough hours, you get a paycheck. And then after the government takes out their money with what they leave you left, that you have got to go to the store and you've got to buy the food and then you've got to fix the food. And all of a sudden there's a little labor involved and it's not manna falling from the sky anymore. Welcome to adulthood. This right here is where Israel entered into the beginning of their adulthood. Only an adult can take the promised land. Only an adult can walk in the promises of God. Children in the kingdom have got to depend on manna or someone else's ability to produce the blessing. And I think God is rearranging a lot of things because he said, you know what? I'm tired of 40-year-old is sitting at the table in their old high chair waiting for somebody to bring the blessing to them instead of them being a blessing. And so there's some things that God is cutting off in the lives of a lot of people, and they think it's the devil, and it's God. Time to grow up. God wants to use you to be the blessing. He wants his authority to flow through you. He wants his power to flow through you. He wants that blessing to flow through you. And he can't do it if you're still stuck in your high chair. You know, and little babies in high chairs are cute, but when you put a 40-year-old in there, it just doesn't work. It's abnormal. But somehow or another, you put a religious slant on it, and it has become acceptable. We have a lot of churches today. They may seat 10,000, but there's 10,000 high chairs. And if you don't get it just right, there becomes a wailing. across the auditorium. Oh, mercy sakes. But guys, God is wanting us to take us beyond manna-falling. The whole time that they were wandering in the wilderness and manna was falling, there was no spiritual warfare. There was none. The spiritual warfare came after they crossed the Jordan. And let me say, probably one of the poorest places to try to engage spiritual warfare is from a high chair. You cannot do spiritual warfare like you're sitting there playing Xbox. It does not require a controller. You've actually got to get out of the chair and do some stuff yourself. You've got to go to the battlefield yourself. God does not allow drones on His battlefield. Now let's pick up here in 13. This is, you know, I've always looked at Joshua's life, and Almighty God appeared to Moses in a burning bush. And the reason He did it was because the Nakash started it in a burning bush. When He appeared as that fiery seraphim in the garden. And so God first appears in the burning bush, and then after He did, and all it took was that to light Moses' fire. He goes down to Egypt, gets the people out. The people meet around God, Mount Sinai. And God causes the entire mountain to burn in His presence. And so now Joshua has to have his moment of special anointing from God. We pick up with this in verse 13. And so they just had Passover. Now Joshua is looking out at Jericho. He's kind of went out in the woods, kind of meditating on, you know, we're going to have to take this city now. Now that we're over here, we're actually going to, I'm going to have to put an army together, and we're going to have to do this. So I can see him trying to figure out, because Jericho, and we'll see next week, has actually had two rings of walls. It had more than one. You know, how am I going to take that thing? How am I going to do that? And so he's kind of out in the woods, just kind of meditating on it, kind of praying through it, while he's looking down on Jericho in the valley of Jericho. And all of a sudden, there's somebody there that shouldn't be there that he confronts. And that's where we pick up in verse 13. And it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and beheld, there stood a man over against him with his saw, with his sword drawn in his hand. Joshua, you know, you have a guy in full armor with his sword drawn. Most guys would have run. This talks about the courageousness of Joshua. Joshua walks up and says, "Who are you? What do you want?" Could you imagine that? There's a guy with a shotgun out in my front yard, so I open up the door, I walk out and say, "What do you want?" But listen what he says here. Because before the battle, God had to readjust his paradigm. 2016 is going to be a year of God readjusting some of our paradigms. It says, Joshua went to him and said, "Art thou for us, or for our adversaries?" We think every battle, it's either us or our adversaries. It's either us or the devil. And so this person says, "Nay." That's just old English for neither one. You for us or you for the enemy? Neither one. You forgot the third position. Man of God. "But as the captain of the hosts of the Lord, I am now come." And with that, Joshua fell on his face and worshiped. You see, sometimes we forget in the battle. You better make sure. You see, there's only two real battle lines. It's not God, you, and the devil. It's God and the devil. And you better make sure which side you're on. And so, Almighty God, and this is a Christophanies or a Theophanies. It is Almighty God manifest in the flesh. When God showed up to Moses, He showed up to him in the burning bush. When God showed up to Joshua, He showed up to him as a man of war. I like that. Because right now we need God to show up as a man of war. This was not an angel. Angels will not allow men to worship them. This was Yahweh Elohim came as a man of war. There's a great book called Who Ate with Abraham, that this messianic scholar in Israel goes and takes apart the Hebrew and shows that this was Jesus, a Christophanes. Jesus was the one who went before them. Jesus is the one who brought the victory. Just like in every battle in our lives, it is Jesus who brings the victory. And what we got to... Guys, this is so pivotal. Listen to me. When Jesus shows up as a man of war, you better make sure you're standing on His side. You don't have a side. It's either His side or the enemy's side. And this was so pivotal in the life of Joshua that from that day on, he made sure that he was on the Lord's side. I imagine with every battle, he began checking his heart. And the only time he didn't check his heart, they had problems. Says, and he fell on his face in worship and said unto them, what saith my Lord unto his servant? And the captain of the Lord's host said unto Joshua, loose thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place wherein thou standest is holy. Kind of sounds like the burning bush, doesn't it? For those of you that were here when I taught on the priest of the believer, why that was so pivotal is the anointing of God was made to flow through earth. Okay? What is 98% of your body made up or 95% of your body made up? Dirt, earth. And there was something shielding Moses when he took off his sandals. He plugged himself in to the power and anointing of God that was radiating in that place that made it holy. Now, Joshua is in the same place. This was where Joshua was anointed for the service that he did because God says, take off anything that insulates you from connecting to me. Oh, there's a sermon in that. What of Babylon is insulating you from the anointing of God? What of Egypt is insulating you? What of this world is insulating you from making full contact? How many times in electronics or dealing with electricity do you have this phantom problem that goes off, goes on, goes off, goes on, and you finally find out where it is? It's because there was a place where there wasn't a proper grounded connection. And then we wonder how come the power of God goes on, goes off, shorts out, does all this in my life. It's because there is something that is insulating us. There is a sin. There is something of the world insulating us from the power of God. And it's time to cast off some shoes to make sure that I'm fully grounded in Him. To prepare for the battle, Joshua had to completely surrender to the captain of the Lord of hosts. And for the battle ahead of us, we have got to quit playing church and start being the church, and we have got to completely surrender, because today the church in the 21st century is how little can I give God and still get to heaven? I am sick and tired of hearing, but that's not a salvation issue. Duh! Salvation is believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. That's a moment in your life. Why don't you go ahead and get saved so that you can walk in the kingdom? Because what we're talking about is the only way into the kingdom is through salvation. But now that you're getting into the kingdom, it's time to surrender to that king and learn how to walk in the laws and the power of that kingdom. Come on in, the water's fine. But we have gotten to the place where when believers finally get into the kiddie pool in the kingdom, you know what I mean by a kiddie pool? Have you ever been to pools? There's little shallow water this big that you can set a baby in. Don't have to worry about the kiddie pool. We finally find somebody, wander down to the kiddie pool, and everybody say, boy, they're deep. Oh, I just can't get over just how deep they are. Oh, they're deep. I want to find the guy that knows how to jump off the high board. I want to find that part of the pool. It's that part of the pool where you learn how to walk on water. It's that part of the pool where you learn how to part the water. I want that. Guys, we've got to make sure, we've got to examine our hearts as we enter into this next year. Whose side are you on? Your side don't count. That is the epitome of self, which is the spirit of Antichrist, to think that you have a side. You don't. Because there's only two lords, either you're serving God or you're serving Lucifer. And there's no other, and you can't stand on the fence. Not where we're headed. Now, generations past may have gotten away with things. We need to understand the closer we get to the Lord's return, the narrower the road becomes. Don't just look at what the past could get away with, because what our past generations got away with is why we're in the position that we're in today. I never thought that I would live in a country that before they aired Charlie Brown Christmas. Now, I don't do Christmas, okay? But still, before they aired Charlie Brown Christmas on ABC Family, they had to give a parental warning that there were strong Christian messages to this program. And I'm thinking, they have poisoned the water hole. Everybody stop and think. You might find out something about Jesus in this. So we got to put up this parental warning. You don't want your kids coming to Jesus. And it's going to get to the place in this nation where we may see that before religious programming. Or if they get their fairness doctrine passed again, if a ministry pays to preach the gospel, then they have got to pay for equal time for an atheist to present their things. And what I have never understood about that fairness doctrine is, so when an atheist projects his things, does he have to buy free airtime for us to present the alternative? That never seemed to work out that way. That doesn't work that way in the liberal mind. But guys, we're here because of the failure of past generations and how Babylon creeps up on you. It's time to wake up. It's time for Jericho and the walls of Jericho to come down. I want to look at Jeremiah 6, 1 through 5. And this is preparing the battle, because it's going to take me two or three sessions just to go through Jericho. What we're going to discover in the next session is there was an ancient evil embedded in Jericho, is one of the reasons that God had them attack it first. That is a pre-flood evil. So Jericho and what we see is actually a great illustration for what we're going to be facing in the days to come. Now Jericho was straitly shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out, none came in. And the Lord said unto Joshua, See, I have given unto thine hand Jericho, and the king thereof, and the mighty men of valor. And ye shall compass the city, all ye men of war, and go around the city once. Thus shalt thou do 6 days. Now I want you to see how many times seven appears in this. Seven priests shall bear the ark of the covenant with seven trumpets of ram's horns. And the seventh day ye shall compass the city seven times. And the priests shall blow with the trumpets. And it shall come to pass, when ye have made a long blast with the ram's horn, and when ye have heard the sound of the trumpet, all the people shall shout with a great shout, and the walls of that city shall fall flat, and the people shall ascend everyone straight before him. Notice how many times, anytime I see seven, and I look for biblical numbers. Seven is the number of spiritual completeness and perfection. It's like there's seven feasts. Why is there seven? Because they're spiritual. That there is a perfection found in them, there is a completeness found in them. You can actually take them, the work of salvation is in seven steps. It's displayed in the seven feasts. And so here we see seven repeating over and over again, because what you're doing is not just something physical, it is something spiritual. God said by accessing something that is spiritual, you're going to tap into higher spatial realities and be able to tap into spiritual power to do things that you cannot do in the natural. That is the task of spiritual warfare. Always has been, always will be. Because you're not come there. Why? Because our warfare is not against flesh and blood, but against what? Principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, wicked spirits in heavenly places, demons, imps, all operating in higher spatial dimensions that were empowering Jericho. And so God says, listen, I'm going to do some things to help you set some things in order. And by these sevens, he said, I'm going to allow you to do something that is spiritual, that includes something that you do physical. You cannot operate spiritually without doing things physically. It's impossible. You can't do it. You cannot sit here and go, what are you doing, Mike? I'm being spiritual. You can't do it. No more than you can sit here and go, what are you doing, Mike? I'm sinning. No, you're not. You're just standing there. There has to be, when because everything is spiritual, it is powered from the spiritual realm. It's either being powered by Lucifer's kingdom or it's powered by God's kingdom. But it causes us to think, to speak, and to do things. And so he was lining them up. They went through circumcision. They went through celebrating Passover. They went through all these things. Joshua had to have his come to Jesus moment, if you will. There, you know, yeah, okay, Lord, I got it now. I'm on your side. Had all this so that they could engage spiritually to come against this stronghold. We're going to get more into what that means next time. Strongholds, because the weapons of warfare are not carnal, but they are power through God to the pulling down of Jerichos built within us. So he said, had the seven priests before the ark with seven trumpets, and on the seventh day, they're going to go around it seven times. And so seven is done, is mentioned four times. And I looked at not only in the English, but I wanted to make sure that seven was only mentioned seven times in the Hebrew, or four times in the Hebrew, and it was. Why this is important is the number four is the number of creation, the number of the world, but it's also the number of Messiah. No. It is the number of Messiah. When did Messiah come? He came in the fourth millennium. The reason that Malachi called him the son of righteousness, S-U-N, is because in the Genesis account, the son was made on the fourth day. And it designated, that's why there was such a high expectation for Messiah in that fourth millennium, because of the prophecies of Malachi. So four is also the number of Messiah. So what they did is God set them up where they were doing something spiritual in obedience to God that tapped into the work of Messiah to pull down those strongholds. And that's the way all spiritual warfare is in our life. It is spiritual, it is emotional, intellectual, and it is physical, but it's in complete submission to Messiah. If I'll do that, the victory's won, regardless of the circumstances. If I don't do that, we can call it spiritual warfare, and all we're doing is beating the air. And I want to end with this. I've seen some Christians that say, and they're doing crazy stuff in spiritual warfare, and it seems like they're getting some results. But there's you know, it's like sometimes Mary and I have kind of held our breath, thinking, "Oh, that ain't right." And it's like you're waiting for the sky to fall, and it doesn't happen right away, because we're dealing with beings that have been around since time began. If you have lived for thousands and thousands of years, what is it to them to wait 5 years to get you in the perfect position for retaliation? We think it's bam, it's going to fall right then. Never happens. They're too sneaky. Because, you know, if guys start doing spiritual warfare wrong and all of them drop dead, everybody quit doing it. I don't think I'm going to do that. You know, it's how long did they figure out not to eat the outside of a cashew because it'd kill you? You know? And so what we've got to do is we've got to step back and look. Where are those people in 5 years? Where are those people in 7 years? Well, he left the Lord, left his wife, left, you know. Well, it looks to me like what he did 5 years ago set him up and put him on the enemy's radar for them to go ahead and set things in his life to take vengeance. And sometimes they'll even build up his ministry or build up her ministry before they show that what was really going on, embezzling money, women on the side, or sometimes guys on the side, or whatever else that we have seen that have come public. Because somewhere along the line, they crossed the enemy and their spiritual warfare wasn't right. The longer you go in spiritual warfare right, and the longer you walk in the kingdom, the harder it is for the devil to get to you, not the easier. And so that we need to learn how to be hard to kill in the kingdom. Hard to trip up in the kingdom. Sure-footed. Didn't David say that, Lord, you make my feet like hind's feet? You know, giving me stability. That through my God, I can leap over war. I can do the things I need to do in spiritual warfare because it's the anointing of God in me. We need to learn how to flow with that and get the weight of Babylon off of us. And that's all what this is about. Let's go ahead and close today in prayer. Father God, we just come to you in the name of Jesus. And Father, we recognize in this battle, we do not have a side. And Father, we relinquish the idea or the thought that we would have the audacity to think that we even had a side. And we surrender to you. We surrender to the kingdom. We surrender to Jesus of Nazareth, who is Almighty God come in the flesh. We surrender to your ways. We surrender to your word. Let your word both correct us and empower us. And Father, we realize the truth that it can never empower us over things that we won't allow it to correct us over. After the correction comes the empowerment. And Father, we yield to your hand. We yield to your kingdom. Father, we ask in this upcoming year that you would show us everything that is in our lives, that is of Babylon, that is of Egypt, that is insulating us from your presence, insulating us from your anointing, insulating us from your holiness. And Father, let us discard it as the filthy rags that it is, just to fully connect to you and your kingdom. Father, give us an anointing this year to work out our salvation with fear and trembling, knowing that it is you who will cause us to will and to do your good pleasure. And that when we get to the end of 2016, Father, that we're going to see radical change in our lives. We're going to move from the high chair to the battlefield. And Father, we thank you and we praise you for it. In Jesus' name.